So, welcome to our third lesson. So, tonight we gonna discuss about doctors, about physicians, and try to figure out what we think about when we think about a doctor, how we identify a doctor, and how many kind of doctors and healers history showed us, and how this this particular figure of a professional that we have the habit of perceive as very settled and defined and steadily. In reality, if we take a look at history, we discover that it is very the question is more more complicated. So in if oh sorry yeah indeed so this is on but it's oh yeah if we want to would like to give a definition of what a doctor is, what would be your first the first things that you would think about? Who is a doctor to you? How do you identify a doctor? And here there's a microphone, maybe for the sake of the room is quite big. I don't know if so I leave a microphone here or when you talk, please raise your voice. So when you think about a doctor, what is the what do you picture?
A white coat.
Yeah, a white coat. Yeah. Yeah. No. It's true. It's true. It's definitely true. Normally, it's a white coat plus something else. What is a medical device? You. Stethoscope. Yeah. Normally is white coat and stethoscope. Normally, statistics says that people tend to figure more easily a man than a woman. But yeah, this is what the common views about doctors from the viewpoint of what image come up in our mind. But yeah, for a basic, very basic definition, a doctor is a person who has a medical degree, a university degree in medicine. But if we want to dig a little bit and to describe what beside a white coat and the stethoscope, people tend to picture when they think about a doctor. They think about yes, someone who is learned in medicine, who has a deep knowledge about the art of healing. Someone also who we can trust. We normally, most of the people start with the assumption that you can trust a physician. You go to see a physician if you are sick, if you have a problem, and you your emotional disposition is I can trust this person. I can I have to listen what he's gonna tell me. We also think about a doctor. What about the social status of a doctor? Is it someone who in society deserve normally respect?
Sometimes.
Yeah. In yeah. Well, let's say that or should deserve respect if a good doctor deserve respect, normally is considered as someone that even is not super rich, but has a decent economic situation, someone who is kind of an authoritarian figure in the sense of he is perceived as an authority within the society. But it's also true that there is also a different image of the doctor that can come in mind as someone who has more negative connotation, and normally what kind of negative characteristics or behavior do you associate to a doctor?
Cold-hearted.
Yeah, cold-hearted. Kind of, yeah, it can be like professional hazard. So if on a daily basis you are at close contact with human tragedies, either you have a nervous breakdown or you develop a kind of insensibility. But yes, the fact that physicians can display this kind of cold-hearted attitude is definitely true. What about their professionality? There is some criticism that normally can be made, or can be associated with a physician. A physician is someone who has power normally. But power can be used for good or for the sake of the patients or for the sake of the doctor, in the interests of the doctor. A physician can mismanage his power, can take advantage of the patients, or in the recent year, physicians are considered not always that competent, because they are because of the several scandals of medical mistakes that unfortunately had tragic consequences. So the public trust in the physician is something that nowadays is very much it's part of the public debate. But a definition about what is a physician, what are the characteristics that are associated to a physician, is also shaped differently according not just to the public view, but also from the viewpoint of disciplines. For example, a sociological perspective, a sociologist, if you ask a sociologist what is a doctor, the answer will be probably different from the answer an historian would give. Sociology would be more focused on what is the behavior of a physician within a society. What is the social function of a physician? Do you recall last week we mentioned an American sociologist, Douglas Parson, who came up with this successful theory of the sick role. He pretend that when someone gets sick consider like a social dysfunction, because someone who is ill is not fulfilling the social roles that he is supposed to fulfill. And the physician comes to normalize the situation. So a sociologist would be, for example, interested in this role of social equalizer of a physician. An historian would rather say that there is no such a thing like a physician, like just one kind of physician, or one collection of characteristics, just one collection that can be associated to the physician, but the history of physician, medics, healers is the history shows us an extreme variety of figures. And tonight we're gonna talk about this. So we're gonna take the viewpoint of an historian, and we'll be choosing this history as a main framework, but we also let sociology and psychology give us some insights in order to discuss about physicians. So let's start with etymology. So it's a funny way to starting an argument. Medicine. So where does this word come from? Well, the Latin verb was from a Latin word medeor, which means to heal. Where the physician come from the Greek word physis, which means nature. So a physician is someone who is well versed in nature, who knows nature and human nature in particular. And you might recall from the last week we mentioned talking about health and illness in primitive culture, the link, the bond with religion in and medicine in primitive culture. We said that sickness, illness in this kind of culture are perceived like something like a punishment from God, the upside, let's say, of this conception, of this perception, is that the healer is perceived like a figure in between the priest and the physician, and as someone who has the capability of healing, because using both his knowledge and the capacity of communicating with God, with supernatural entities, is a mysterious figure, which is both we can be both be respected and feared, because he's dealing with something that is beyond the nature. And in the ancient Greece and Rome, we find this kind of overlapping between medicine and religion. We mentioned the gods of medicine and healing that are figures that figure in the Greek pantheon, but also considering the physician, the doctors in ancient Greece, they are more similar to a priest. If you want, they are priests of Asclepius, for example, and a traditional way for dealing with sickness, with illness, could be was for example, a sick person goes to the temple of Asclepius, he sleeps inside the temple, he's supposed to have dreams, and he's supposed to be visited by the god, and the god is supposed to tell him what to do to recover, and the Asclepius priest is supposed to correctly interpret the dreams of this person. So you see something that is in between sacred and the domain of the sacred and domain of the of the secular, because we mentioned also that in the Greek and Roman antiquities, some more secular views about what about health and illness were formulated. But it is interesting to recall that Hippocrates pretended to have. To descend in a certain way, even if not directly, by the god of medicine. This was, even if his idea of what of the origins of illness and the ways of recovery were secular, the fact of presenting himself as in a certain way linked, connected to the god of medicine, was a way for him to be more credible and for his theories to be more easily accepted. But what did a physician in the antiquity look like? What kind of education, what kind of cure he performed? Well, a physician in the antiquity meant to be also a philosopher. In both the text of Hippocrates and Galen, we find this strict connection between medicine and philosophy. The use of the reason, the capacity of observing and thinking about what has been observed is one of the key characteristics of a physician. A physician uses his mind. He uses also his senses, because the use of all the five senses is specifically prescribed and in great detail by both Galen and Hippocrates. A physician needs to look at the patient, look at the signs of illness, to need to touch the patient, to see, to physically see, to physically test if his body has some problem. Need to listen to the patient. An important part of the work of a physician in the antiquity was to listen to what the patient has to say, what are his if he's in pain, what kind of pain, where, starting from when, and so on and so forth. And once all these elements, all these data are collected, the physician is supposed to reflect, to carefully consider all these elements, and when is absolutely sure, certain of his diagnosis, then he can communicate it to the patient. So it's a work that is considered something that implies a big responsibility and need to be done with great decision. Need to be to show to be careful. A physician needs also to display moral qualities, because one of the actions of the physician that enables the recovery is to display moral integrity and empathy toward the patient. Concerning the education, well, there was not such a thing like schools, medical schools in the antiquity. Sometimes you can find in philosophy or history books the medical school of Hippocrates, and you might think about an equestrian school where Hippocrates taught to a bunch of students. No, there was no such a thing, because basically the way for learning medicine at the time was just to be trained by a physician. It was like more like an apprenticeship. And if there are some, there were some cities, particularly known for medical education. It was just because some very notorious physicians lived there. For example, Kos was the birthplace of Hippocrates. Pergamon was the birthplace of Galen. Alexandria in Egypt was one of the cities of knowledge, the capital of knowledge of the antiquity. So a person who wanted to be to become a physician just had to travel, basically, to go to Kos, to Pergamon, to Alexandria, for example, and to be trained by a physician. And then he would be considered fit to practice. There was no such a thing like certifications or diplomas, or it was really learning on the job. It was a free profession in the sense that everybody could become a physician, could exerce medicine, even if he was not a freeman. In Rome, it was not unusual for example, wealthy families to have slaves trained in well versed in medicine, that live in with the family and were the physician of a wealthy family. It was also free in the sense that there were no such a thing like guilds or let's say union, corporation, like institution, or that might enable a kind of consciousness of the profession. And and it was a paid job that a physician claim to be paid after after the treatment. Well, in some cases in the antiquity we find some figures public doctors, in the sense that one doctor could be hired by a city, for example, and paid by the, for example, the city council, and in that case he uses his arts for free. But it's not as frequent as we can imagine, and sometimes this happened more frequently when, in the case of epidemics, a city could hire a physician just for this specific case. And let's move to the Middle Ages, another moment in of history when we recalled the overlapping between medicine and religion continues. In this picture, you can see a monk. You could identify by the absence of hair. And apparently giving medical advice to a sick person who is in bed. Well, in the Middle Ages, at the beginning of the Middle Ages in particular, physicians were normally monks. And this for several reasons. Well, we can make connections with the fact that Christianity continues to associate the figure of the healer to the figure of the Christ. In the Gospel, the Christ performs some miraculous acts of healing, and the saints too. In the sacred history, the saints are claimed to perform some acts of healing, and also the fact of being charitable is one of the virtues of a good Christian, but Most importantly, in the beginning, at the beginning of the Middle Ages, monks were those who copied, translated, and created a tradition and transmission of the books of Hippocrates and Galen. And it's not. It makes sense that the medical knowledge started having its home in a monastery, for example. Another kind of knowledge that adds in the Middle Ages to what a physician was supposed to know is astrology. This sounds odd, isn't it? Yes. Astrology, yes, but try to think about it, and if you have to make a guess, what has to do astrology with medicine? Astrology, yes, the planets and the zodiac and so on and so forth.
To explain why are you incurable?
Maybe it was believed that the stars impacted the health of the patient, or they dictated the times at which it was best to do the medical treatment.
Yeah. Do you know the word influenza? What is where the origin of this word is by the influence of the stars, the kind of aura that the stars project to the earth. There was this belief that indeed the position and move of the planets, the movement of the stars, the characteristics of the sky, of the sky in the sense of the astrological disposition of the constellation, had an impact on, for example, the happening of epidemics. Yes, there was a question.
Just interested, like, so people saw that star was born for a million years, special for people to say that you need to have a penicillin.
I'm not sure. I understood your question.
So, like, if. The astrologist at that time, like, forgot about one star, that could be like a catastrophe for medicine?
Well, you need to think about what the way the people at the time pictured the sky and thought the sky and the planets were the configuration of the universe, what was consistently different from now. So they're still working with the Ptolemaic system, so the Earth is flat, the Earth and the center of the universe, and all the other stars and planets move around it. The calculation also, the ways of observing the stars were definitely, let's say, not at the point of our actual technology. Think about, so we are talking about the early Middle Ages, whether Galileo and the telescope came centuries later. But the belief that there is a connection between the stars and the happening of health and illness made sense for people at the time, and also they believe in a kind of correspondence of each body part to I don't know, the moon, the sun, a particular constellation, and so on. So there was a way to calculated and to predict indeed the happening of a disease, or to spot the cause of a disease. Oh, you got this terrible you felt ill, you are sick till for you have been sick for months, is because the planet I don't know, Mercury was in this position in the sky. So and astrology actually was considered a legitimate and proper science for centuries. I mentioned Galileo before. He was also, besides being a polymath, he was also an astrologist. He used to write horoscopes for the family, the Medicis. Yeah, it makes, yeah. Yeah, but the Middle Age was also the time when university appeared and the first medical faculties were created. So, when with the creation of universities and the first medical faculties after the 11th century, actually the status of the physician starts changing, because monks and clerks are more and more discouraged from the exercise and from the study, not the exercise, the study of medicine, also the exercise of medicine. There are a series of councils organized by the church that, for example, prevent monks to leave their the place where they live, their abbey, and we know that the medical knowledge was linked to the capacity of traveling. Bear in mind that all this happened before the invention of the printing. That means that the books were extremely rare, and even big cities, big universities, as just a dozen of books of if a library, if a university library, for example, had at the time a dozen of books of medicine, was considered like a huge library. And well, clerks are discouraged from the exercise of medicine, also because medicine still remains a work. For a doctor continued to ask money for their service, and this was considered not appropriate for as opposite to the principle of free charity of the Christianity. And so the first medical faculties are created. Here's just a few cities where the older medical faculties are created. So Salerno, which is a city in the southern of Italy, close to in the region of Naples. Bologna, also in Italy, but more in the central northern part. And Padua, again in Italy, but in the region of Venice. Montpellier and Paris in France. Montpellier is in the south part of France. Paris, well, Paris is the center north of the country. So in these universities, medical schools are created. But what was a medical faculty? What did mean at the time to go to a medical faculty? What kind of education a student could receive? Well, starting from the Middle Age, really medicine became an intellectual labor, became an intellectual profession. There is not such a thing like a uniform curriculum, even if a kind of formalization of medical studies starts at the time. In general, students need to have a bachelor degree in literature before, in order to get to enroll a medical school. And in medical school, they can remain between the average was 5 or 6 years. The study that they, the education they received was according to the protocol of the scholastic education, scholastic in the sense of the scholastic philosophy, which means that they learned the works of Hippocrates, of Galen, of the Arabic medicine, and they were supposed to show to their teacher their knowledge, to be capable of lecturing, of defending a thesis, of they had to display the capacity of having argumentation. They need to display a rhetoric capacity. So it was really more an intellectual exercise, if you will, than a practical activity. A medicine was not supposed to make a dissection, for example, to touch to perform, for example, a bloodletting, which was one of the most common medical procedures at the time. So, this way of framing the medical studies made medicine, the faculty, the study of medicine, raised to the highest degrees of education, being an intellectual education, led medicine to be on the same page as faculty like law or even theology. And a series of rites, if you want, of formal, a kind of ritualization is put in place in medical faculties. Medical faculties start delivering degrees, which means that students, in order to graduate, need to pass an exam. And after an exam, there is a ceremony for the graduation in which the student's doctor received a particular hat, a golden ring, a golden belt, and so it's a way of displaying a legitimation. A physician is recognized as such, as a proper physician, because he had a medical degree, it has been recognized as doctor by a medical school. Most of the students enrolling this kind of education are secular, not member of the church, but the church continues to survey this particular place of knowledge for several reasons, because the church wanted to be sure that no heretic theories were spread in this university. For example, the theory that says that the blood circulates. This was considered as contrary to what canonic authoritative text said, that were recognized as true by the church. Which means that happened in the past that people claiming that the blood circulate was were condemned as heretics, and the church wanted to be extremely informed about the practice of dissection, because lectures of anatomy were part of the medical education. They were not performed by a doctor, they were performed by normally a surgeon, a barber surgeon, with a doctor guiding the surgeon. So now you cut here, now you open there, now you pull this part of the body in this way, and so on. And in this old medical school, there are the so-called anatomic theaters. Like, imagine a theater, but the architecture is like a cone, and with the capacity of more or less 200 students, and they are conceived their structure in a way they are kind of jewelry, a masterpiece of architecture, because even the students who is seated in the farthest place from the operating table, which is at the center of the theater, can see clearly what is happening. And it's really fascinating. And in Padua, it's the theater has been renewed recently, and it's people can enter, can visit, and can have this incredible perception that you think you are far away, you think you're not gonna see anything, and no, you see clearly and you hear everything. But let's come to the early modern era. So this is basically what comes up when you search on image database, physician early modern era. So this is the apparatus that the physician used to wear if they had to enter a city or to approach someone who got the plague. This kind of mask with a beak. It's not like for carnival or for a disguised party. Or do you know what was in the beak?
Herbs.
Exactly. And why?
Because he can breathe air in rooms with sick people, so he don't get sick. Something like that.
Because the smell was disgusting, so to not. And it was believed that it will defend you from some bacteria which caused that illness. So it was like protection.
But this is true. There was herbs inside with that purpose was to protect the physician, not from bacteria, because bacteria the bacteriology was late, but what was called the miasms. The idea is if the air is corrupted, and this is why people get sick. But with this apparatus, I can. Avoid to breathe this kind of corrupted hair. I let you imagine what kind of wonderful device of contagion was this robe. Can you imagine what kind of sick people can produce a physician dressed that way? But in the early modern era, so some changes happened that modified the perception of a physician. For example, the invention of the printing in the 15th century. This made the medical books cheaper, and which means more easily available. They circulated more easily, but also this means that the physician could start, for example, writing, and they could publishing in very easily. This was important if we recall that in the early modern era, some of the canons of the medicine starts to be put into question. The philosophy of the empiricism we have seen the last week start spreading in the intellectual environment. And the new medical theories, new medical views start coming to the eyes of the profession. But being a physician is still an intellectual profession. A physician is still someone who who exerts his profession without direct contact with the patient. Contrary to what we can imagine or can guess, being a physician didn't mean to have a social recognition, to have a social stability, or even to have a regular income. This really depends on several factors, because still whether, and we will see later, other kind of medical profession like surgeon, they have a kind of professional organization that let them clearly situated within the society and defend sometimes maintain a certain characteristics, for example, of training and education. If you are not properly trained or properly educated, you are not allowed in our guild. No such a thing exists at the time for a physician, which means that even a fancy degree cannot be enough for a physician to make a living. And that this means that we have in the early modern era a lot of physicians that a lot of different figures of physicians and physicians that might do other kind of jobs and plus exert the medical activity. For example, let's start from the top, the court physician. Well, kings used to have, still have, a physician, personal physician. In the case of, for example, the court of France, there was a part of the royal mansion. Royal mansion in the sense, not the physical sense, in the administrative sense of the government, let's say, that was the medical, the royal medical mansion, which means a bunch of physicians selected to take care of the king. Sorry. This was a charge that normally was bought by a physician. That pay money to be appointed as a court physician because this was a very prestigious position that allowed it, well, normally to have a title to become an aristocrat and to get access to wealthy clients, wealthy patients. Also, that means that physicians in this particular position were member of the court and were involved in all the social and political dynamics of a kingdom and of the court. They were the idea that the physician is someone you can trust made this kind of physician get, for example, jobs like ambassadors or even like spies. There are some cases of physicians at the court of the prince, of monarchs, or even prince of seniors, that you read their lives, it seems to read a spy story, because you forgot they were medics, that you forgot that they were physicians, because in their life they did completely other things. But it's absolutely frequent the case of physicians who were, for example, notary or entrepreneurs, businessmen, because of that, of this general lack of stability of the medical profession. This does not mean that there weren't physicians who made a living by through the through medicine, but. We need to also keep in mind that a physician is was at the time not alone, not the only one who could heal. there are a lot of non-regular healer that makes that are on the same market of the graduated physician. We will see in more detail in a moment. But let's come to the modern era in which the medical profession starts stabilizing and becoming and assuming the characteristics of what is now a physician. The stabilization was brought by several factors. The rise of institutions, hospitals, clinics, universities with more developed medical degrees and education, and most importantly, the process of specialization of the medicine. Because all the doctors we mentioned till now, all the education as medical students received in universities or elsewhere till the modern era were not specialistic, were not framed in specialties. A physician learned to heal the whole body of a person. But starting from the middle of the 19th century, a process of specialization began. And we start having ophthalmologists, gynecologists, cardiologists, psychiatrists, or specialists of, infectious disease, specialists on the treatment of children, and so on and so forth. And if you had to make a guess, to you, what could have been the reasons that pushed toward this the creation of these specialties?
More information about the body?
Yes.
Yes, there is a considerable augmentation of the knowledge, the quantity of knowledge, and you might say, and it makes sense to think that too much knowledge is not manageable. You need to split it in different chunks. Yes?
There may be also more advanced technologies.
Yeah, the fact that technological advancement happened in this moment is also linked to the specialization. It is hard in both the case, but both are, according to historians of medicine, process that has an impact that are directly linked to the rise of the specialization. But it's hard to say if it was the augmentation, for example, of knowledge on, a specific body apparatus was at the origin of the specialization of on this particular body apparatus, or a consequence of the interest of physicians on a particular part of the body. The question of the origin of the specialization is not consensual in academia. Some scholars, for example, think that one of the main causes was the demographic trend of the time, the augmentation of the population, then the consequent need for more physicians. Or world, the fact that there was so too much competition among the physicians. So some physicians started thinking, well, if I present myself as a specialist, I don't know, of the ears and nose and throat, I might have better chance to get clients. There is an historian of the medicine called George Weiss who wrote a book called Divide and Conquer, and he endorsed this thesis. Specialization started because of the excessive competition among physicians. And by the way, the process of the specialization was in the first place disregarded and criticized by physicians, by professors of medicine in the university, because they saw in this process a kind of corruption of the true spirit and the true mission of the true nature of medicine, which is they value more a physician who has the capacity of have a complete world vision of a human body, instead of someone who just focus on one aspect, apparatus, one organ of the body. But this trend basically didn't stop, and the specialization is someone that is one of the main characteristics of medicine that we know. Just a quick historical note. So, according to the historians of medicine, we can officially say that a medical specialty is born when there is professional associations that claims that they are specialists of for example, ophthalmology. There are meetings, regular conferences organized by the specialists. There are journals who published on this particular specialty. And there are institutions, hospitals or wards or university courses that are that focused on this specialty. But we have just talked about physicians, but they are not the only kind of healers that were around in time. Let's spend a little bit of time on talking about surgeons. So this is awful. Yeah, because it's a scene of it's a scene, the scene of an amputation, and look at the background. What kind is the context of this amputation?
It's a war.
It's a war. Yeah. Well, surgery is historically associated a practice that is associated to war. And amputation was one of the most practiced surgical operation performed for century. I recall that, and we discussed about this in the lecture about pain, about the use of anesthetic is extremely recent in the history of medicine. It started being generalized in the early 20th century. Physicians were reluctant to use drugs or other devices that could stop the pain, not because they were sadistics, but because they would consider the pain of a patient like an important sign for a physician, like something that the physician could use to be more effective in his procedure. But well, this is a scene of war surgery. But surgery as a practice is extremely old. We have proof of surgery practiced in the ancient Egypt. This is a scene of brain surgery. Not because they were especially versed in neurology, but because one of the procedures that were practiced at the time were the trepanation of the skull in order to heal mental, what we call now mental illness, more in the spirit of that time, to let the evil spirits go out of the head of a patient. This is an inscription that shows medical surgical instruments, and this is well, a recent edition of a papyrus called the Edwin Smith Papyrus, from the name of the explorer who discovered this papyrus, who was basically a treatise of surgery that was found that dates from the old Egypt. But when we talk about surgeries, probably one of the most, when we talk about the history of surgery, one of the most iconic figures that come in, the first figures that comes to mind is the barber surgeon. And why the barber to you at the time has this kind of double identity? Because nowadays we do not ask a barber anymore to practice bloodletting or to pull out a tooth with if that causes us pain. To you, what is the link between surgery and the profession of a barber?
Because they could touch the people.
They could touch the people. Yes. Something more. They work with knife. They're skilled to manipulate the sharp instruments. And you might think that this kind of professional has no surgical proper competence at all. It's kind of an amateur that is as a kind of to-do attitude for bloodletting people. But a kind of learned surgery existed even in if you go back in the past. There were actual schools of surgery in frequently in the same city, well-renewed, well-known medicine faculty were around. In the city of Bologna, for example, city of one of the most ancient university in of the world, and one of the most prestigious medical schools, there were a school of surgery, the same in Paris. A series of canonic texts about surgery were written, and students used to, for example, study this book, the Chirurgia Magna, written by a French surgeon called Guy de Chauillac, because if medicine, if physician didn't have a professional organization, it's not the case for surgeon. And the case of French history of surgery is particularly emblematic, because French surgeon has this, let's call it professional association, called the Confraternity of Saints Cosmas and Damian. Cosmas and Damian were two Arab surgeons who were lifted to sainthood because they performed for free. And the members of the this fraternity, in order to be admitted within the fraternity, need to pass an exam, need to show to that knowledge and their knowledge and their skills. And there were two different level, let's say, of two different kind of membership. Sorry for it's not appropriate term, but the robe, the short and the long robe. So the surgeon that has the long robe were considered the more educated, and they were at a moment in time they were they get access to the education of a physician. They could go to medical school and to perform medicine. The surgeon with the robe, the shorter, you see here, they were of an inferior level, more similar to the barber surgeon. But so the story of this fraternity, tells a lot about the fact that an educated, learned surgery existed. So we mentioned the proximity with and the cooperation with the medical faculties. In the 15th century, the surgeon with the long robe were authorized to practice medicine. This, of course, didn't like very much to the medical faculties that started a real war against the fraternity of surgeons and obtained the dissolution in 1660. But eventually, surgery came a second era of glory in France, thanks to King Louis XIV, le Roi Soleil, who founded in 1731 the Royal Academy of Surgery. So what happened? So basically it's a story which seems anecdotical, but which it is anecdotical, but it's very much it was very much impactful on history. The king suffered of what was called at the time anal fistula. It's an infection of the anus, extremely painful, and I let you imagine the routine of personal hygiene that were around at the time didn't facilitate the recovery. Well, basically, all the doctors of the Royal Mansion of Medicine failed to treat the king, and the one who successfully operated the king of this fistula was a surgeon called Charles-François Félix. And the king was so happy and grateful that decided to display his gratitude by creating this Royal Academy that made surgery once again a decent, a proper profession. But physicians and surgeons were not the only example of people you could go to see when in case of health issues. Most importantly, was not the person that used to treat the most majority of sick people. It was more people like this guy had a lot more of clients or patients. The bone setter. Here is a recent example of bone setter. It's delivering an apparently painful massage or treatment at the back of this poor guy. But the bone setter was a key figure, for example, in the countryside, in till the ancient eras. It was the person that you might go to see if you have problem, for example, with your ankle or with your shoulders, all the kind of injuries that are extremely frequent in the countryside. If you work as if you are a patient, if you work in the fields, and so on and so forth. So you have a problem or a broken leg and so on, you do not go to the surgeon, you do not go to the physician because you don't trust them and because you can't afford them. You go to the bone setter. It's a figure that in the village everybody knows, that everybody trusts, and that even if he doesn't have a fancy degree or diplomas, he has a practical knowledge and is effective for treating this kind of ailments. Another example of a medical figure that is not a doctor, the midwife. The midwife are The existence of midwives is attested till the ancient time. It has been for centuries the only kind of medical profession accessible to women. Normally, a midwife is a woman who is not just is an expert in the enabling childbirth and in general women's health. She asks to be paid, obviously. And for centuries, this particular figure remains outside the official medicine. A process of medicalization of childbirth started from the end at the end of the 18th century. It's a process that had been described by studied by historians starting from the 1970s. When the first feminine studies began, and the history of medicalization of the childbirth has been described as a way for cast out women from the let's say proximity to the medical profession and to instate a control on women's body. So this this position is not shared by all the academia, but it is true that starting from the end of the 18th century, a process of regulation and professionalization of midwiveries began. Today we would say gynecology, is perhaps the first medical specialty ever consolidated, and it started in the end of the 18th century, way before the trend of the specialization, the big trend of specialization in medicine began. And nowadays, well, the figure of the midwife still exists. It depends a lot according to different countries. For example, in Italy, it's not as frequent as, for example, in France, in which is a proper paramedical profession regulated with a midwife as a university diploma, pass an a state exam, and can exert in public hospitals. And a profession which is open also to male practitioner. And that in the recent years, with the criticism toward the what is perceived as excessive medicalization of childbirth, is becoming more and more frequent. For example, for a woman can choose to give birth at home with the assistance of a midwife instead of going to a hospital, because I don't know, she thinks that in hospital she's gonna be mistreated by rude gynecologists, or have the risk of having a C-section when it's not necessary, just because the hospital is more lucrative to perform a C-section than a natural childbirth. Yes, when we talk about the medics, healers, and so on, we also need to spend a few words about the so-called charlatans. This is a kind of iconic representation of a charlatan, like a man who wants to sell snake oil because it's a universal medication. Who is a charlatan to you? What does this word...
A tricky man.
Sorry?
A tricky man.
A tricky man. Yeah, someone who wants, for example, to claim that he can heal all the possible diseases and normally ask for a lot of money and goes away without waiting for let's see the damage done. But yeah, the history of charlatanism, what is called charlatanism, is not a linear history because, well, from the very beginning, physicians in the medical profession, the need of make a distinction between the legitimate profession and the illegitimate profession was perceived as an important question. For example, the claim that we mentioned about the necessity for a physician to be a philosopher that we find in the books of Galen and Hippocrates was to make a clear distinction between the proper physicians and the charlatans. And this kind of divide is present toward the whole history of the medical profession. But it's kind of a fluid history because there are medical practices that now we can legitimately call as charlatanism, but that for centuries has been considered absolutely legitimate. Today we do not ask an astrologist about our back pain, which was because an astrologist giving advice about a back pain, it's sounds not like the most trusty professional that we could find. But as we have seen, for centuries, astrology was considered as a key element of the education of a physician. The same, for example, we mentioned briefly last week, phrenology, the art, let's say, of spotting the characteristics of and the attitude and the behavior of a person just according to the shape of the skull. But another example is mesmerism. Have you ever heard about Franz Mesmer or mesmerism? It was Franz Mesmer. He was a German doctor, and he believed that sickness are caused basically by the fact that magnetic fluid that, according to him, circulated in the living beings, humans, animals, sometimes didn't circulate properly. And he used magnets in order to, as a therapeutic device, in order to restate the correct circulation. He used to perform his treatment in theaters. He made tours of Europe. He was not just in Vienna, but in London, in Paris, and he was capable of filling theaters with this kind of demonstration. And we could think that yes, this is kind of an example of a charlatan because it can be thinkable that a disease could be cured with such an eccentric way. But his ideas were very close to, for example, the so-called vitalistic medicine, which was a school of medicine, school in the sense of stream of thoughts, that was endorsed in the 18th century by the medical school of Montpellier, one of the most ancient and prestigious medical school in the world. And the vitalist, the physician called the vitalist, thought that there was a kind of vital energy circulating within the body that in case of proper fluid circulation keep the body healthy, but in the case of improper difficulty for circulation provoked was the cause of the disease. And this idea is really similar to what to the claim of Mesmer, but Mesmer was labeled as a charlatan at his time. But I would like to finish with a few words about alternative medicine. Because now, so what do you think when about, if you have to name an example of alternative medicine or non-conventional medicine, what would you mention?
Non-conventional?
Yeah.
Hypnosis.
Yes, hypnotherapy, for example, is considered, can be considered an example of alternative medicine.
You have examples of alternative medicine, right?
Yeah.
Homeopathy.
Yeah.
Maybe
acupuncture? Yeah.
Yeah.
Or I don't know, Ayurveda, or and why to you this as why do you this all these examples are correct? They fall in the label of alternative medicine. But why are these kind of therapeutics alternative?
Because you don't know will work it or not.
Mm.
No, not for all people about homeopathy. I don't believe in it at all.
Yeah, you said an interesting word. You see, I don't believe in it because it's like, and it is true, alternative medicine tend to be perceived as something that is not really legitimate. It's something that borderline between it's more like a potion than a proper medicine, proper medication. Which means that they are considered alternative because in the first place there is they are disregarded by the official medicine. A proper doctor with the medical degrees working to a hospital and so on and so forth. If you ask a surgeon what does he think about Ayurveda, he say ha ha ha, normally. But well, consider the alternative medicine are more than kind of something, a phenomenon that is just a trend. Because is a kind of this kind of therapeutics are gaining more and more space, and also are going through processes of legitimation. You have, for example, schools delivering diplomas of acupuncture. And this is a kind of acupuncture. It's also an example that says this kind of therapeutic is considered not legitimate here in this part of the world, whether in China is not absolutely not the case. Or someone mentioned homeopathy. Homeopathy was invented in the early 19th century, and for a few decades it was considered a proper medicine. There was homeopathic hospitals, and then it was completely delegitimated by the so-called allopathic medicine, that doesn't believe that if you have, I don't know, headache, you should take something to that provokes you further headache, because this makes your body react and you get better. But a process of more and more of so-called alternative medicine are going to a process of legitimization. There are schools that enable diplomas, and in certain cases even the public authority recognize these kind of therapeutic. For example, in Germany, you can ask for a reimbursement by the state for homeopathic treatment. This is not the case, for example, in Italy. It's not considered legitimate enough. Or in France, you can go to an osteopath, a kinesiotherapist, which is the modern version of the bone setter, if you want. But this is not the case, for example, in Spain. So the kind of the criteria that makes a specific kind of medicine as perceived or recognized as legitimate medicine or illegitimate are really fluid. That doesn't and do not depend on the fact that a kind of therapeutic can be more or less efficient, performative. Because taking a look at the ratios of failure of the traditional medicine, there are discussions that could be made at this.
I'm just interested, but people always need to believe in something. It may be a religion or human and etc. So could be an alternative medicine like a placebo effect for people who just lose her all ways to go and try to be healthy with the help of pseudo.
The placebo effect actually is also used in traditional, let's say, legitimate official medicine, because it's a psychological process that can enable recovering in a patient. It is. If you want, clinically proved. The question is the reason why certain kind of therapeutics, certain kind of medicine are considered as alternative, as not real medicine, not proper medicine. It really depends not that much from the results, because. You can have statistics for the efficacy of, medicine in a hospital. Well, it's easy. It's a public structure or private structure, but it's controlled, it's monitored. You do not have the same kind of data available for acupuncture and so on and so forth. So you can't say statistical viewpoint. And think also about studies. This shows that from the sociological viewpoint, those who tend to trust the most such alternative medicines are young generation, educated people and women. Grandparents are skeptical towards this and tend to trust the licensed doctor. My grandmother would more likely was more likely to trust I don't know her neighbor than a licensed physician. So, not legitimate medicine. So the fact that a kind of therapeutic is legitimate and perceived as legitimate, and it's really something that cannot be decided or claimed just from statistical data. It really involves the society, a particular society, a particular culture, the values of a culture, and history, or also philosophy of medicine. That there is we can discuss about that in one of the next lessons. There is a strong group of philosophers of medicine that argues and have arguments against the scientific claim of the claims of scientific medicine, because they say they pretend that medicine is a science, is objective, whether it's just a logical construction that makes sense, but like a theorema, you could imagine a different paradigm, and that from the theoretical viewpoint has the same validity. And it's most because one particular culture in one particular time believe that something is objective, that is considered as such. And they ask this, normally philosophers that want to go make this kind of demonstration ask to people, can you, do you believe, I don't know, that the technology is objective, is reliable, and so on and so forth. Can you explain how your cell phone works?
Like inside?
It's not enough. Can you explain? Can you, no. But you you consider it as a device that that functions. Well, we are out of time. we'll be continue to discuss of this question during the seminar, and we will talk about the history of medicine in a few days. Thank you so much, and have a nice evening. And there is a board for signing. I thought it was circulating.
Excuse me, is that?